Hello friends, I am Dr. Kamala Upadhyay. Today's lecture is on Fasciola hepatica, which is also called as a flatworm or liver fluke. In this lecture, we will see its life cycle with pathogenicity and control measures. So let's start. So friend, Fasciola hepatica, which is commonly called as sheep liver fluke because it is commonly found in liver of the sheep, that's why the name given, sheep liver fluke. So before we go in detail about this animal, about its life cycle, let's see its systematic position. So friend, Fasciola hepatica, it is kept in phylum Platyhelminthes because of their acoelomate triploblastic bilaterally symmetrical and vermiform body, which is dorsoventrally flattened and which do not have any kind of skeleton. That's why they are kept in phylum Platyhelminthes. Then their class is Trematoda. In Trematoda, they are included because of their ecto and endoparasite, and mostly they are flatworms, which are commonly called as flukes. Then their body is dorsoventrally flattened, which looks like a leaf, or you can say the structure of the body is leaf-like. That's why. Then they have suckers, which in which they do not have any kind of hooks. Then their order is Digenia, because they are mostly endoparasite in invertebrates as well as in vertebrates. That's why. And they have two suckers, which are firstly oral and another one is acetabulum, but both of these suckers, they do not have any kind of hooks. Then they have a single exterior pore at their posterior end, and the uterus have numerous celled eggs. Then their larval cycle have so many larval stages, which include two or three intermediate hosts. That's why they are kept in order Digenia. Then the family is Fasciolidae, because they have two suckers which in which they do not have any kind of hooks. Then body is looks like a leaf, and which is dorsoventrally flattened and devoid of any skeleton. Then they are hermaphrodite and endoparasite. That's why the family is Fasciolidae. And finally, the genus, which is Fasciola. In Latin, Fasciola means small bandage, means they looks like small bandage. And the species name is Hepatica. Hepatica is based on the name of the liver. In Greek, hyper means liver. That's why the species name given Hepatica. So friend, it is a small bandage like animal which lives inside the liver. That's why the name given Fasciola hepatica. Now let's see the life history of Fasciola hepatica, which is first time described by Thomas in the year 1883. Then if we see its distribution, then it is cosmopolitan in distribution, means wherever the sheep or cattle are raised, then these are found in that area. So you can say it is a cosmopolitan in distribution. Then its habitat, it shows that it is an endoparasite which complete its life cycle within two hosts, and its primary host is sheep, where it occurs in its liver, and its secondary host is limnia, or you can say a freshwater gastropod, limnia, a snail, okay, or the similar kind of species like Planorbis or Bulinus, etc. And the disease caused by Fasciola hepatica is called as fasciolysis, or it is also called as liver rot. So friend, the life cycle of Fasciola hepatica is very interesting. It includes so many larval stages. But before we see in detail about its larval or its life cycle, let's see how the animal looks. So in this picture, you can see two species of Fasciola. First one, which is larger one, it is Fasciola gigantica, and it is the common fluke of the cattle. And another one is Fasciola hepatica, which is slightly smaller than Fasciola gigantica. So in both picture, you can see it having two suckers. First one is oral sucker or anterior sucker, and another one is called as acetabulum or posterior sucker. But these sucker, it do not have any kind of hooks. Its anterior end, that is called as mouth, or you can say it contain mouth. And its posterior end, it having a excretory pore. Then near its acetabulum you can see a gonopore is there, and its body looks like leaf. This segment is showing Fasciola hepatica's reproductive system. So friend, as I told you that this animal is hermaphrodite in nature, means both male and female gonads, they are found in same animal. So try to remember all its reproductive parts so that it will help you to understand its life cycle. So we will start from its male gonads, which are testis, and testis is found in a pair, and its one testis, which is located towards the anterior end, is called as anterior testis, and the testis which is located towards the posterior end is called as posterior testis. Then you can see a tube like structures are originating from the both of the testis, which is called as vas deferens. Then this vas deferens is connected to a place which is called as acetabulum, from where they unite and form seminal vesicle, and this seminal vesicle is surrounded by prostate gland, and finally the prostate gland is again forming towards its anterior end ejaculatory duct. This ejaculatory duct is surrounding by a muscular structure which is called as serous, and from serous this whole structure is opening to outside with male genital aperture, and finally to exterior this male genital aperture opened with a common gonopore, from where the female genital aperture also opened. In case of female reproductive organ, you can see it have a single ovary which is highly branched, and it is connected to a small tube like structure which is called as Lorenz canal, and after this it is again forming a highly convoluted tubule which is called as uterus, or you can say uterus is highly convoluted and it is opening to outside through a female genital aperture, and finally female genital aperture opened to outside with a common gonopore, from where male genital aperture also opened. Oviduct is again connecting to a median vitelline duct, and this median vitelline duct is connected to, or you can say it is swell up and form yolk reservoir, and yolk reservoir from its both side it is connected to transverse vitelline duct. Okay, and this transverse vitelline duct is again connecting from its both side through a lateral longitudinal vitelline duct, and this lateral longitudinal vitelline duct, they are forming again vitelline glands. So friend, in this animal it having two types of glands, which are vitelline glands or vitellaria, and another one is Mehle's gland or shell glands. So the secretion of the Mehle's gland, it help in lubricating uterus, while it also act for the activation of the sperm. In case of this vitelline glands or vitellaria, they produces yolk cells which provide nourishment to the embryo, and also they form cell globules. Okay, but in case of Mehle's glands, its another name is shell glands, but it do not work for the formation of the cell of the egg. In next segment we will see the detailed structure of the female reproductive organ. This segment is showing female reproductive organs of Fasciola hepatica in detail. Here you can see a highly branched ovary which is connected to a common duct which is called as oviduct, or you can say all the branches of the ovary, they are connected to a common duct called as oviduct, where fertilization takes place. Then this oviduct is give rising a small muscular structure or canal which is called as Lorenz canal. So friend, this Lorenz canal is a temporary opening for the copulation during its breeding period, and through it opens to outside through a median dorsal pore and act like a vagina during copulation. Now this oviduct is again forming a highly convoluted tubule which is called as uterus, where so many fertilized eggs are there, and this uterus is opening to outside through a female genital pore. Now here in position number 2 you can see oviduct is again extend, and it is connected to a median vitelline duct, and this median vitelline duct is swell up, and it form yolk reservoir. And from its both side, the yolk reservoir is connected to transverse vitelline duct. Okay, and this is the whole structure of female reproductive organs. Beside this, you can see some of the male reproductive parts also here, like seminal vesicles. Seminal vesicles is forming ejaculatory duct towards the anterior end, and this ejaculatory duct is connected to a muscular structure which is called as serous, which act like a copulatory organ during its breeding season. And finally, this serous is opening to outside through a male genital aperture, and male genital aperture opens to outside via a common pore which is called as gonopore. So this is the whole structure of fasciola hepatica's male and female reproductive organ. So friend, let's revise the reproductive organs of fasciola hepatica. As I told you, it is a hermaphrodite animal where male and female genital reproductive organs, they are found in same animal. Male and female genital ducts, they open to a common genital atrium, or you can say in a common genital atrium, and this genital atrium, they opens to outside through a common pore which is called as gonopore or genital aperture. Now let's see its male reproductive organ. Here we already seen that it have a pair of testes, and the anterior one is called as anterior testes, and posteriorly located testes is called as posterior testes, and both are highly branched, and from where they connected to a tube-like structure which is called as vasa differentia, means both of the testes, they have their individual vasa differentia, and these vasa differentia, they unite at acetabulum. Then this acetabulum, where they form a seminal vesicles which is a pear-shaped, or it stores its sperm. And this seminal vesicles runs anteriorly and form a tube which is called as ejaculatory duct. This ejaculatory duct is surrounded by muscular structure which is called as serous, and this serous act like is copulatory organ. It extend up to the male genital atrium or male genital aperture. And finally, this male genital aperture opens to outside through a pore which is called as gonopore. The female reproductive organ, it contain a single ovary which is highly branched and located anteriorly, and all the branches of the ovary, they are connected to a common duct which is called as oviduct. This oviduct give rise to a small canal which is called as Lorenz canal. So friend, this Lorenz canal act as a vagina during its copulation period, and it is a temporary opening for the fertilization also. Then oviduct, it extend and connected to a median vitelline duct. Finally, this median vitelline duct, it swell up and form yolk reservoir, and this yolk reservoir, from its both side, it is connected to the transverse vitelline duct. Okay, now friend, from the oviduct, it again give rise to a highly convoluted tubule which is called as uterus, where all the fertilized celled eggs are there, and then finally this uterus is opened to outside through a female genital atrium, and this female genital atrium, it opens outside through a common gonopore. So friend, this is the whole outline of the female reproductive organ and as well as the male reproductive organ. So I hope it will help you to understand the all the parts of the male and female reproductive organs of the fasciola hepatica. Now let's see the life cycle of fasciola hepatica. So the life cycle of fasciola hepatica is a digenetic life cycle, because it completes its life cycle within two host, that's why it is called as digenetic life cycle. And its primary host is sheep, where it lives as a adult, and it also lays eggs in this primary host. Then its secondary host or intermediate host is the snail, which is called as Limnia truncatula or Planorbis or Bulinus, etc. So friend, in intermediate host, it lives as a so many larval stages. Then its life cycle starts with copulation, and copulation is takes place through cross fertilization, and copulation always takes place in bile ducts of primary host. Okay, then during the process of copulation, serous of one fluke is everted and it insert inside the Lorer's canal, and through the Lorer's canal it releases its spermatozoa, and during this process the secretion of prostate gland of one fluke and the Mehle's gland of another fluke, they keep active with the sperm during the fertilization, and finally the fertilization takes place at the distal end of the oviduct. So fertilization is always cross fertilization in this animal, and it is internal. If in case the self-fertilization occurs, then in that case sperms enters the uterus of the same fluke where they fertilize the ova. Okay, so you can see the outline of the fertilization here also, so that you will understand very clearly the fertilization process. So friend, if the cross fertilization occurs, then it occurs through Lorer's canal, from where it or you can say one fasciola hepatica, it releases its spermatozoa through this Lorer's canal, and finally the fertilization takes place at the distal end of the oviduct. If self-fertilization occurs, then the sperm of same fluke through female genital aperture, they enters to the uterus of the same fluke, and finally fertilization takes place. So friend, the very peculiar feature of the fasciola hepatica after fertilization is that it forms a capsule around the fertilized egg. So in this process, the zygote, which is surrounded by yolk cells, as you can see in figure, these yolk cells, they contain cell globules, and within this cell globules it is formed by proteins and phenol. Then the phenol component of the cell globules, it oxidized in proximal parts of the uterus and it converts into quinone. Then this quinone, it tends the protein and produce a hard leathery sclerotin. This sclerotin finally form a hard shell around egg, and now this structure is called as capsule, and this capsule contains a lid or operculum. So you can see the structure of the capsule around the egg or zygote. So friend, a single fluke may have 3000 or more such capsules in its uterus, and in a liver of sheep there may be 200 or more fluke at a time. So you can calculate the total number of the capsule within a sheep's liver. In this segment you can see the flowchart of capsule formation. So friend, this flowchart will help you to understand the whole process very quickly through this method. So as soon as the fertilization occurred and zygote is formed, then the zygote is surrounded by yolk cells, as you can see in figure. Then these yolk cells, they contain cell globules, and cell globules are formed by proteins and phenol. Then the phenol component of the cell globule, it is oxidized in proximal parts of the uterus and it converts into quinone. This quinone then tends the protein of cell globules and produce a hard leathery thing which is called as sclerotin. Now this sclerotin form a hard cell around egg, and now the whole structure is called as capsule. So friend, this capsule also contain a lid or operculum. So friend, the capsule formation or the whole process, it increases the chances of its survival, or you can say the capsule protects the egg and increases the chances of the survival of the race. Okay, that's why. So friend, as the zygote is formed and finally it is covered with the capsule, then the embryonic development starts inside it, and this development starts with the start of the cleavage. And firstly, the cleavage is always taken place in this animal is holoblastic and unequal, and the first division of the zygote results in two unequal size of the cell, and the larger one is called as its somatic cell, while the smaller smaller cell is called as its propagatory cell. So friend, the somatic cell, it finally give rise to host ectoderm and its tissue, while the propagatory cell, it again divide and results into two daughter cells. One of its daughter cell, it again divide many times and form its germ cells, and these germ cells, they accumulate in the mass of the cells in its posterior part of the body, while the another daughter cell, it again divide and finally form the larval body. So friend, after the cleavage, the encapsulated embryo, it do not stay in the uterus, and it comes out from the gonopore, and via the fecal matter of the host, it goes outside of the body, and further development of the larva takes place now outside of the body. This segment is showing flowchart of process of cleavage. So friend, as I told you, after the formation of zygote and capsule, then the embryonic development is started, and it starts with the start of the cleavage, and cleavage is always holoblastic and unequal, and first division of the zygote is results into two cells, and among which one is larger in size and another one is smaller in size. The larger cell is called as somatic cell, while the smaller one is called as propagatory cell. The somatic cell, it again divide and form the larval body, like a larval ectoderm and tissue, while the propagatory cell, it divide and results into two daughter cells. Its first daughter cell, it divide many times and form germ cells. So friend, these germ cells are actually a mass of cell which accumulate at its posterior part of the body, while the other daughter cell, it again divide and form the larval body. So from this stage, the encapsulated embryo or capsule, it do not stay in the uterus, and finally it comes out through the gonopore of the fasciola, and it through the fecal matter of the host, it comes out from the host body, and then further development of this capsule takes place outside of the body. This segment is showing the early embryonic development of fasciola hepatica, which we already understand or understood with previous segment. Okay, so here you can see in figure A the zygote, which is in capsule. Then in figure B, you can see in the cleavage is started, and it results in two unequal size cell, like propagatory cell and somatic cell, and these are surrounded by the yolk cells. Then in figure C, you can see many cell stage. Then finally the figure D, this is the stage when the capsule, it comes out from the host body, and further development of the capsule takes place outside of the body in the form of next stage, which is called as Miracidium larva. So when the capsule comes out from the host body, then if it get the suitable environment, then the further development of the larva is started, and Miracidium larva is the first larval stage of fasciola hepatica. So friend, remember this thing, that fasciola hepatica is, it shows so many larval stages, and this Miracidium larval stage is its first larval stage, and this next stage is developed when it get the suitable environment, like 60% of moisture should be there, or it should be in contact of the water, and the pH should be 6.5, which is slightly acidic, and the temperature should be 22 degree centigrade to 25 degree centigrade. Okay, then the hatching is started if it get all these suitable environment, and hatching is started by the proteolytic enzyme, and this proteolytic enzyme help to dissolve the cementing material of the operculum, so that the operculum, which act like a lid, it opened, and the Miracidium larva, it comes out from the capsule, and all this process is takes place during favorable condition when the capsule comes out from the host body, and it takes place about 14 to 15 days duration to differentiate into myriacidium larva. Okay, so the myriacidium larva, it swims with the help of its cilia, because its whole body is covered with cilia, and these cilia help it to swimming. And always remember this thing, that myriacidium larval phase is a non-feeding phase, means it do not feed in its myriacidium larval phase. So it should be find out its next intermediate host, which is Planorbis or the snail or the bulinus, etc. And if it get the its intermediate host, then the next larval stages is started. Or in other case, if it do not find out its next intermediate host, then they die. This figure is showing external structure of myriacidium larva of Fasciola hepatica. So friend, as I told you, it is a non-feeding stage, and so it have to find out within 24 hours the next host, that is snail, so that its next larval stages are started with the help of the nourishment of the next host, which is snail. So as you can see in this picture, it is an external structure which having its apical papilla, then cilia which covers its whole body, then a pair of eye spot is there, then you can see epidermal plates or cells are also there. So this is the structure of its myriacidium stage. So friend, as the myriacidium larva, it gets its next host, which is limnia, then with the help of its apical papilla and through boring movements and contraction and expansions of the body, then it starts boring itself inside the host body. Okay, and during this process, it also use its flesh dissolving secretion, so that the flesh of the snail is dissolved, means the epidermis of the snail is dissolved, and with the help of its squeezing mechanism, then it enters inside the host body. And during the same time, it also shed off all its cilia outside of the host body, means when it enters inside the host body, then its whole body is now non-ciliated, and then the further development of the larva takes place inside the host body, and it goes to the next larval stage, which is called as sporosis larva. In this segment, you can see the all stages of penetration of myriacidium through snail epidermis, and which I already explained in previous segment. So friend, in about 14 days, the myriacidium larva, it converts into sporosis larva, and it also looks like this myriacidium larva, except the ciliated body covering, and this ciliated body covering is replaced by the thin cuticle. Beside this, it also do not contain any glands, brain and eye spot, but it contains a protonephridium of each side, which is divided to form its flame cell, and they open to the outside through its excretory pore. And it also contains germ balls, and which later on develop into its radial larva by absorbing the nutrition from the host body. Okay, so each sporosis larva, remember this thing, that it produces 5 to 8 radii. So here is the sporosis larva of Fasciola hepatica. So as you can see, the body is covered by the thin cuticle, and which is followed by the epithelial layer. Inside the body, you can see there are so many radii larvae, okay, or the radia, with many germ balls are also there, and protonephridium from both sides, which are give rising to flame cells. So friend, as you have seen that myriacidium larva, when it comes in contact with the snail, then it goes inside its digestive gland, where its further development is takes place, and it converts into the next larval stage, which is called as sporosis larva, within 14 to 15 days. Okay, so the each sporosis larva, it give rise to 5 to 8 radii, and these radii, they comes out from the sporocyst by rupturing its body wall, and their shape is cylindrical, and they measures about 1.3 mm to 1.6 mm in their length. and they have their mouth and collar, and also they have many germ balls inside them. Then these radial larvae, they migrate to the digestive gland of the snail, and during favorable condition they further give rise to their next generation of radii, and each radia can give rise to about 14 to 20 Sarcaria larvae, which is their next larval stage. So you can see here, in every larval stage the number of the their next generation is increasing. Now let's see the figure of the radia, and this figure is showing radia with Sarcaria inside it. So here you can see the body of the radia is cylindrical, and it contains a mouth, and mouth is followed by pharyngeal glands, and gut is also there, and the body is covered by cuticle, and this cuticle is followed by many epithelial cell, and towards its anterior end there is a muscular structure which is called as collar. Then you can see a birth pore is also there, and inside their body it also contain many germ cells with many Sarcaria. And a peculiar characteristic of the radia is that it having a outgrowth towards its posterior side at its both end or both side, which are called as lappets. Then inside it there are so many germ balls are also present, means the whole body having many germ balls. Now the each radial larva, they give rise to the next generation of the larva, which is called a Sarcaria larva, and each radial larva they can produce 14 to 20 Sarcaria larva, and these Sarcaria larva they comes out from its birth pore and they enters in snail's digestive gland. Okay, so the mature Sarcaria, they start now moving to host tissue and migrate to its pulmonary sac, from where they escape to the surrounding water. So to comes out from the snail body, the temperature should be 19 degrees centigrade to 26 degrees centigrade, so that the Sarcaria they comes out from the snail's body. Okay, so now the Sarcaria they start moving in water with the help of their tail, and after 2 or 3 days then they start their encystment, and they attach themselves some aquatic plants and to become the next larval stage, which is called as Metasarcaria larva. Here you can see the picture of Sarcaria larva of Fasciola hepatica. So friend, now in this stage it starts looking like the adult fluke. Okay, so as you can see, it also having two its sucker, like oral sucker and acetabulum, and this oral sucker is followed by its muscular pharynx and esophagus and a U-shaped gut. Then it also contains its flame cell with cytogenous gland cell. Excretory vesicle is also there, and germ cells are there, and it also contain a tail, and this tail help it in movement in water when it comes out from the snail body. So as soon as the Sarcaria larva, it comes out from the host body and it starts moving in water, and after 2 or 3 days then it loses its tail and it goes to its next stage of larval stage, which is called as Metasarcaria, and in this stage it starts its encystment. So friend, the thousands of Metasarcaria are found to attest to a single grass blade. So you can imagine that a single grass blade can contain thousands of Metasarcaria, and in this stage the Metasarcaria, they are juvenile fluke form, and that's why they are called as Marita, and their Metasarcaria form is looks like a cyst, and so that the cyst is rounded in structure, and inside it there are so many flame cells, and excretory bladder, it opens out directly through a single pore, and this cyst wall protect themselves against adverse condition as well as desiccation, and the thick cyst wall, it is formed by the cytogenous gland cells of the larva. Okay, so this cyst wall soon it degenerates if it is ingested by the primary host, which is sheep with the grass. Here is the picture of Fasciola hepatica's Metasarcaria form. So you can see the structure is like a cyst and it contains a cyst wall, and this cyst wall is formed by the cytogenous gland of the larva. Okay, so inside it you can see mouth with its oral sucker, then muscular pharynx is there, and gut is also there. Acetabulum is present and many flame cells are there, and with excretory canal and excretory vesicle. So friend, as the metasarcina is converted into its encysted form and attached itself to a grass, then the grass, or you can say the infected grass, is ingested by the primary host, which is maybe sheep or goat or other cattle. Then these metasarcina, they reach to the host proximal part of the intestine, and during this journey, the cyst wall, it protect the larva from being digested from the digestive juices of the intestine, and so it finally reaches to intestine, where its cyst wall is dissolved and the larva comes out and it starts penetrating to the intestinal wall, and it reaches to the coelomic cavity, and finally it enters into the liver, where it feed and it feed on its tissues, then grow its size, and within 5 weeks after reaching in this area, then it attain its sexual maturity, and it goes to the bile duct, and where it lays egg. So friend, within you can say 11 to 13 weeks after entering the body of the host, it starts laying eggs, and again the life cycle is started with the fertilization and formation of the capsule and so on. This segment is showing the Fasciola hepatica's complete life cycle. So friend, are you ready to revise the life cycle with me? Okay, so let's start. So we will start with position number 1. So we know now that the life cycle of Fasciola hepatica is a digenetic life cycle, means it completes its life cycle within two hosts, and its primary host is sheep or goat, or it may be cattle, where it live inside its liver and damage the liver tissue and obtained its nourishment from the tissue and get its sexual maturity. And from its metasarcaria to its adult form, it takes place about 11 to 13 week duration for the conversion of the adult fluke. Okay, then here now we also know that this animal is a hermaphrodite animal, means the male and female reproductive parts, they are found in same animal, and always cross fertilization takes place in this animal, and the eggs, they are fertilized inside its oviduct, or if self fertilization occurred, then the fertilization takes place in its uterus. Okay, so now the fertilized egg, which is called as zygote, it is surrounded by yolk cells and it contains cell globules, and these cell globules, they contain proteins and phenol, and this phenol component of the these yolk cell, it convert into, or you can say it oxidized into the chemical which is called as quinone. This quinone tends protein and produce a hard leathery thing which is called as sclerotin. Now this sclerotin is responsible for the formation of a cell around the zygote. So the zygote, now it is capsulated inside the capsule. Okay, then this zygote is undergoes the next stage of embryonic development, which is called as cleavage. So the cleavage starts with the result of two unequal size cell. The larger one cell is called a somatic cell, while the smaller cell is called as propagatory cell, and the cleavage is also holoblastic. Okay, so the somatic cell, they again divide and they form its ectoderm and tissue, while the propagatory cell, it give rise to two daughter cell. One of the daughter cell, it divide and form its germ cells, which are accumulated in the form of cell mass in its posterior part of the body. But the other daughter cell, it again divide and form the larval body. So now here the capsule. It do not stayed in the uterus of the fasciola hepatica, and it comes out through the gonopore, and through the bile duct of the host it goes to intestine, and finally with fecal matter the capsules they are comes out from the host body, and their further development takes place outside of the body of the host. Okay, so when these capsules they get the suitable environment, means they come in contact with moisture or water, and pH should be 6.5, temperature should be 22 degrees centigrade to 25 degrees centigrade, then the proteolytic enzyme it hatch and it starts opening the cementing material of the operculum or the lid of the capsule. And finally, after 14 to 15 days, the opening of the operculum started, and the Miracidium larva, which is the first larval stage of the fasciola hepatica, it comes out from the capsule and starts moving in water with the help of its cilia. Now here, one thing should be remembered, friend, that Miracidium larval stage is fasciola hepatica's non-feeding stage. Okay, so it should be find out within 24 hours its next host, which is snail, or if they do not get the next host then they die. If they get, then with the help of their apical papilla and contraction and expansions of the body, and with the help of their flesh dissolving secretion, they start boring movement in its or you can say in epidermis of the snail, and they dissolve the epidermal layer of the snail, and they squeeze themselves inside the snail's body, and during this process they also shed off their cilia outside of the snail's body. Okay, so when they fully reach inside the snail body, then at that time they are non-ciliated Miracidium larva. So now this Miracidium larva, it when enters inside the snail, then it moves in digestive gland of the snail, and where various changes occurs in its body, and after 14 days it goes to its next larval stage, which is called as sporocyst larva, and this sporocyst larva is however resembles with this Miracidium larva other than the presence of the cilia. So in this sporocyst larva it do not have any kind of cilia, plus many glands, and plus the eye spot are also absent in sporocyst larva. So the sporocyst larva, now it starts absorbing nutrition from the snail's tissue and moves on the host tissue, and it give rise to about 5 to 8 its next larval form, which is called as radia larva. So these radia larva, they rupture the wall of the sporocyst and they comes out from the sporocyst, and they again during their favorable condition they give rise to their next generation or second generation of radia, which are called as cercaria larva. So each radia larva it can give rise to 14 to 20 number of cercaria larva. So you can see here that in every step of the larval form the number of the adults are increasing. So friend, remember this thing, that when Miracidium larva it enters inside the snail body, from here to the formation of the cercaria larva, which comes out from the radial larva, it takes place about 35 to 65 days duration. Okay, so when the cercaria larva it comes out from the birth pore of the radial larva, it in this stage it resembled to the adult fluke, and now it starts moving in water for 2 or 3 days, then it goes to its next larval stage, which is called as metacercaria larva. Then this metacercaria larva it form a cyst wall around its body and found attached to the grass. So thousands of metacercaria they are found to attach to the grass, and now they wait that the primary host, which is sheep or goat or other cattles, they come and ingest them with the grass, and so that their further development takes place inside the proximal part of the intestine, from where they goes to the liver. Okay, so by this the whole life cycle is completed within this primary host as well as in secondary host. Now let's see the disease caused by fasciola hepatica and its symptom. So friend, the disease caused by fasciola hepatica is commonly called as liver rot or fasciolysis. In this disease, the fluke enters in the liver of the sheep or goat, or it could be a man, then where it starts the damaging the liver tissue and also consume it, and it starts laying hundreds of eggs there in its bile duct. And as a result, the liver is highly damaged and ulcers are also there, and bleeding also started in liver, and liver is swell up, and finally the bile ducts it block, and the whole condition is called as fasciolysis or liver rot. So the symptoms for the disease are like abdominal pain occurred during the fasciolysis. Then the infected man, it feel nausea, diarrhea and vomiting. And during its primary stages of infection, the infected man, it having fever, then weight loss is also there, and the infected man, it also feel hives and bleeding of the liver, and ulceration in the bile duct are also found. Then the infected man also feel mellitus, which results in its obstructive jaundice. Now let's see the diagnosis of the liver rot. So the diagnosis are always made by finding yellow brown eggs in the stool, and the specimens are examined under a microscope. And to find out the parasite, more than one specimen are needed. So friend, if a person has eaten the infected liver, or you can say a healthy man has eaten the liver which is infected, then the eggs are passed through the body and they are out via feces. In that case also the results are positive, but the man is not infected by the liver rot. The another diagnosis process, which is polymerase chain reaction, they are still at its experimental stage. So you can say that diagnosis is always made by the finding yellow brown eggs in the stool. Now let's see the treatment. So friend, the treatment of the infection is not so easy because the difficulties to introducing drug in the bile passages of infected man or cattle. But the drug which is triclabendazole, it is the only medicine which work against fasciolysis, and it is very active against both immature and adult parasites. The prevention of fasciolysis can be controlled by the control of the intermediate host, which is its vector or snail. And beside this, many other control measures can be taken, like by killing heavily infected sheep and destroying the eggs and manure of infected sheep. Then destroying the snail by adding copper sulfate solution in ponds and ditches. Again, the information and education of peoples about the parasite, and communicating among peoples for promoting cultivation of vegetables in water free from fecal pollution. Then through cooking of vegetables before consumption. And finally, the treatment of domestic animals and enforcing separations between the husbandry and humans. So these are the some prevention methods to control the fasciolysis. In this segment, it's an exercise for you friends. So you have to fill up the blank boxes which are in blue color. So you have to fill up the different larval stages of life cycle of Fasciola hepatica in it. And it is also a kind of revision of the life cycle of Fasciola hepatica. So by this, the whole lecture on Fasciola hepatica, its life cycle, its disease and the diagnosis, then the treatment and prevention of the Fasciola hepatica is completed. I hope this lecture will help you in your studies. Thank you.